All right, welcome back to another podcast here on the Brunson Podcast. This is the story of my life, my journey, my lessons, my pains, the whole shebang. So we're going to get back into it. Last episode, I mentioned that I was talking to a friend. We went to lunch, and we were in this Mexican restaurant, and we were sitting there talking about, and I said, hey, like, he has you know, a decent number of employees. And I said, so tell me, like, how's it been managing people? And we started talking about it, and both of us had just a little, you know, he's had a lot more experience than I have probably, but for me, I'm just being very genuine. I don't enjoy it. I don't like it at all. I really hope I don't have to do it again. I feel like I know that I will at some point, but we're always, to some degree or another, we're always influencing and leading, but I just don't like being a manager at all. It's not something I enjoy. But I've been trying to, I want to be good at it because it's one of the most valuable skills under the sun. And as we were talking, he said, tell me, what have you learned about it? Which is just an awesome question. As I thought about it, I was like, you know, a lot of different things, but it what came to mind was a philosophy I've been working on for years now. It started a long time ago, and I want to tell you some stories first. I have a friend who is a teenager now, who actually cannot read. Well, barely. He can barely read. And that's actually pretty recent. And it was just so interesting because I thought, man, how can you know, if you ever met this person, you would never know. You would never be the wiser until you actually pulled out something and had to read it. This friend of mine, he has constantly had to fight and struggle in life, though. As a result, and here's what's interesting, and this is what's so fascinating to me, and many of you will probably relate to this. This friend of mine has practically a photographic memory, and I mean that in the sense that he forgets nothing. You can drive somewhere, he will always find his way back. You can ask him where something, like, hey, do you know where, a book is? He's like, oh yeah, it's over, and he can tell you the exact location, the way it's laying down on the table, everything. His mind is just absolutely incredible at retention. If you, I mean, again, and growing up, right, for him, he's like, yeah, you know, you go to a restaurant and, you know, you start reading off a menu, he memorizes it as you speak it out, like, because he knows he's only got one shot on it. His ability to retain information and audiobooks, his ability to listen to audiobook and actually get everything out of it, which is very difficult from my experience, it's incredible. It's absolutely incredible. But that's kind of part of his superpower. He's highly dyslexic. I mean, he's got, like, essentially two things working against him. He has an eye problem mixed with dyslexia, and it's like the worst combination ever for being able to read. And even at that, he's still being able to read very slowly now. Just an absolute trooper. Another example for me was growing up. My older and younger brother, the three of us are very, very similar in a few specific ways, and every other way we are so different, it's absolutely mind-boggling. We look a lot alike. I probably look the least like my brothers, but my older and younger brother, actually, people think they're twins even. Yet, we are so, so different in personality and the way we even perceive the world and, like, everything. It's just really interesting, but we're actually very close, very good friends. Growing up, though, I was the intellectual. I was the one that loved to read. I loved to study. I loved philosophy. Some of my friends that were adults, they, and a few of my cousins even, they called me Mini Marcus Aurelius growing up, because I was always thinking, right? I was always just, like, philosophizing, like, man, I wonder why this, and I was always asking why. I'm like, but why does the world work this way? Like, what is truth? You know, that was the kind of questions I asked. Like, what is existence? How do you know that yourself are real? You know, like, this, as a 12-year-old, I thought these kind of questions. As a 12-year-old, and those of you that know me know that I have a very deep belief in God, but as a 12-year-old, I had serious doubts about God, because I started studying Darwinism and some of the theories of Nietzsche and just different people, and I just thought, man, so that's a whole different story. But as a result, what happened is I developed a reputation of being quote-unquote smart, which, by the way, is the worst thing that I think you can ever tell a child, is that they're smart, and I'll tell you why later. But I developed this reputation of being the smart kid, right? And as a result, I put a lot of stock into it. And this is me being very vulnerable, honestly. This is not something I like to talk about because I'm not proud of it, but I was a very arrogant kid and teenager. And it's still something I struggle with to this day. I'm not going to claim for a second that I don't still struggle with that, but I've become much wiser at realizing how far I am from from being as smart as I thought I was. Every day I grow a little more wise and a little less, what's the word I'm looking for? Every day I realize how little I actually know. More and more every day it's become mind-boggling how absolutely pathetically ignorant I am to life. But as a young kid, I really thought I had a lot figured out. And as a result, I often would look down to people around me that I thought were not quote unquote intellectual like I was. And I thought that I had life better figured out than they did. And there was one time in particular there were several times in particular where I kind of just was like in a disagreement. I'm like, hey, no, listen, like you don't understand. You just don't see things the way that I do. And I'd say that very often. You just don't see things the way that I do. Man, what an ironic statement that was. And after being wrong many, 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 many times, when I was convinced, I had crunched all the numbers, it all made sense in my mind, I had it all figured out. And my brothers, especially, because we have very different like ways that we think. And they would disagree with me. And I would be completely bent, just convinced that I was correct about a certain situation. We actually worked together. We'd mow lawns together, wash windows together. We, you know, did all these things. And so often we had business disagreements on how we would scale the business. And I had very strong opinions on what was the right way to do it, because I'd read the books. I was like, no, I read a book on this. Like, trust me, I know. And I've thought a long time about this. And when I think a long time about things, it means I'm right. And that was kind of my perspective. And then I was constantly amazed how frequently I was just dead wrong. I go, what? I thought through this. Like, how did this not happen the way that I thought it was going to happen? This doesn't make any sense. And my brothers both were just gifted with my mom's gift of just incredible instincts. They don't think the way that I do, but they will feel what's right way before I get there intellectually. It's very, very common. So there will be a problem and they'll just go boom, and immediately they'll have a decision on it. I'm going, there's no way you could have thought through that fast. And my brother didn't have to think through it. I just feel that it's right. I trust my instincts. I'm like, that doesn't make any sense. Okay, and here's a great example. So, my brother, my older brother, is a phenomenal operator on anything that has a motor in it. He's just very talented. We ride a lot of motorcycles. There was a particular time that I think I was trying to, we were trying to get over some obstacle, right? We do a lot of trials motorcycle riding in my family. We're trying to get over a particular obstacle, and I'm sitting there for probably 20, 30 minutes analyzing all the minute details of, okay, the surface tension in the rock. Okay, I'm going to be going how many miles per hour? Okay, what would that... I'm trying to go mathematic on this thing and intellectualize myself over this giant rock, essentially, right? And my dad's like, hey, Peyton, give that a shot. And he's like, okay, starts at the motorcycle. Wham, bam, boom, jump up and over it. No problem. I'm like, okay, so I get up there as I'm thinking, my brain's going haywire, right? Just, okay, think of this. And then all of a sudden, as I get closer and closer, my brain does the opposite thing where it's like, okay, how are you going to bail? Okay, if you fall this way, your back's broken. You fall that way, your hip's broken. You fall that way, you're going to crack open your head. Like, my brain's just going completely nuts, right? Obviously, I crashed again and again and again. And that was very common. And Peyton, my older brother, just was like on fire. He didn't have to think through things. He just instinctively got it. Now, why am I telling you all this background about my family? Because this is what opened me up to a concept about what I call the five intelligences. This is where I really started to realize that there is clearly not just one intelligence out there. And at first I thought, okay, there's two. There's an emotional intelligence and intellectual intelligence. Like then after a while I realized, no, there's more than that. And I've identified many, many different intelligences. I've tried to kind of narrow them down to about five though. I consider like the five core intelligences. Now, funny enough, what I've also realized is that society seems to follow a very similar trend on the value they place on each of these intelligences. So we'll go through them really quickly. Intelligence one is what I call a physical intelligence. That has a lot to do with everything I talked about with my brother. My brother has an extremely high physical intelligence. He just does it. His body is able to perform in such a way, he doesn't have to think about it. His instincts take over. His body performs remarkably well under pressure. A lot of your great athletes have an extremely high physical intelligence. Not the only thing, but that's definitely a big one. Their bodies just do well under that. Now, society's long time placed that. That goes back all the way to hunter-gatherer days, right? High physical intelligence was an ability to perform well under stress, pressure, and like your body just performs well. It's an ability to think without thinking. And let your instincts take over, and it protects you, and it's why these humans have done incredible things. I mean, it's how you can take down a grizzly bear, right? With nothing but a spear. You just let the body do what it needs to do, and it's pretty remarkable what a person with a high physical intelligence can do. So that's the baseline, and then this is kind of a cross-up depending on what society you look at, but we're gonna, for just the sake of the order that I've created, we'll say that the second one is an intellectual intelligence, and that's IQ, right? Plain and simple. And I don't think I have to go into too much detail on that. The third level is a social intelligence. This is an ability that someone has to connect with people, to create bonds, to create relationships, all of the above that goes with that. It's something that, and you see this in our society, right now this is actually where I think we really emphasize is social intelligence. It's an ability to make friends quickly. It's an ability to work well with others. It's an ability to be a good leader even. That is a high social intelligence. And there's a lot of value in our society placed on that. But you notice that, yeah, starts off with a physical intelligence. It's who's the strongest, who's the fastest, who has the best physical ability. Then it moves on to an intellectual, okay, who's the smartest. And then we start to realize, okay, maybe smart is not all that's cracked up to be. You guys, you're seeing this in the world today. I know people that have incredible IQs, and they're practically useless. I mean that in the sense that unless they're told what to do, they get stumped. They're not leaders. They have trouble working with people. They have trouble. They're very good at one thing. And it's almost, in fact, it's almost a damning, ability because as my dad has told me more times than I can count, he who is good with a hammer thinks everything is a nail. Those that are intellectual think that all things must be solved intellectually. Massive pitfall that I fall into. Third, again, is that social intelligence, an ability to connect with people. And then the fourth one, and this is where I believe our society is leaning towards today, we're starting to discover, is an emotional intelligence, which essentially is an ability to deal with stress. Okay, so what is, right now, we don't struggle from hoping to not get eaten every day. We've long since surpassed that. We don't struggle, especially in America, with a constant threat of life. We think we do because we're a little bit soft, but we really don't. It's shocking when someone dies a tragic death, but you take it back a few hundred years, it was never shocking when someone died a tragic death. It was just something that seemed to happen fairly frequently. So now what's happened is now it's shifted from a physical danger to an emotional danger. Now we struggle more than ever with depression, anxiety, suicide, addiction, all of those things. So what is emotional intelligence? It's a mix of things. But one of them is an ability to cope with those emotional detriments. An emotional intelligence is an ability to have strong control over your soul, your emotions, your ability to deal with stress, anxiety, pressure. Again, going back to great athletes, a lot of them have a very high emotional intelligence as well. They can deal well under pressure. The clock's ticking, 10 seconds left on the clock, and the ability to just make magic happen. That is what I think is a high emotional intelligence. Furthermore, an emotional intelligence also has a lot to do with your ability to feel what is right, to feel, to sense, to perceive in ways that the brain can't keep up with, to get gut instincts, as we call that, or the common sense. All of that to me is an emotional intelligence. And like many things, can be developed, and we'll go into that in here just a little bit as well. But number five, and this is one that I think that we haven't discovered yet. I think that we have very little concept of how profound this is, and I think we're just getting into it. Well, actually, it depends which society you look at. I believe that the top one is a spiritual intelligence, and that to me, actually, and oh man, there's so much I can go into this. I believe that all of these intelligences actually have kind of a yin and a yang. There's a dark side and a light side to each one of them. Depending on how it is used. It's an ability to connect with things that are unseen. This might sound hokey to a lot of you, I'm sure, but hear me out. There is a lot going on behind the scenes that we do not see. We talked about vibration last time a little bit. That is just a fraction of it. I don't care if you believe in God or any kind of a deity or an energy or something. I've met very few people in my life that believe truly in nothing. I think it's hard to believe in nothing. You have to believe that there is something out there. I'm not saying that you have to believe it's a person or whatever else, but there is clearly something that you can sense out there. That is my perspective. I've tried to push that away in my life, and I could not do it. At the end of the day, I had to admit there is something out there. And the more I discovered, the more I dug, I found a deep belief in God. But with all that being said, the ability, a spiritual intelligence is an ability to connect with whatever's out there. It's an ability to connect with higher energy. It's an ability to perceive things that are far beyond even an emotional intelligence. Why is love so powerful? Love is the great healer of all things, isn't it? And some people can just sense that. Some people can perceive that because it's an eternal law. Gratitude is an eternal law. Giving of yourself is an eternal law. And if you want to read some great eternal laws, read the words of Jesus Christ in the Bible. He talks a lot about lose your life and you shall save it. A profound truth that's way deeper than anything that the brain really, because it doesn't make sense to the brain. But those that live it just experience things that can't really be intellectualized. We are constantly in a state where we're proving the brain wrong over and over and over again. A spiritual intelligence is an ability to tap into higher truth, tap into things that are beyond us. On the flip end, I do believe that there is a darkness out there. Some people call it Satan. Some people call it evil. Some people, there's a thousand names for it, but whatever it is out there, there is something out there that's negative. And an ability to tap into that is also a spiritual intelligence. I actually believe this after spending a lot of time in Russia, that people in Russia actually have a remarkably high spiritual intelligence. And that may sound weird to a lot of people, but I believe this. They are very, very, very superstitious. I believe that is a fruit, if you will, of those that have a high spiritual intelligence but lack the correct resources to connect with it in what I think is the correct way. They become very superstitious because they sense this. They're constantly sensing there's things that are going on that they cannot see or perceive. The funny thing about it is that these people that I spent time with in Russia embraced very deeply things that were considered very deep spiritual truths. And it was obvious for them. I found this constant. We would talk about these deep spiritual ideas that some of them had never heard of. And as soon as they heard it, they said, oh, that makes a lot of sense. Like, I've never heard an American say that, ever. Not with things like this, you know. And for them, it's just like, oh, obviously. I look at Eastern medicine and Eastern healing and the philosophy of, like, you know, India and China and different places. High spiritual intelligence. An ability to connect with a higher vibration, for lack of a better word. A lot of the study into chakras and spiritual healing and all of that. Maybe you don't believe in it, but at the end of the day, just look at the fruits of it. That's all I have to say. And people that have a high spiritual intelligence, they just get it. It makes sense to them. The risk of having a high spiritual intelligence is that you need to find good, clean information. Otherwise, I think you become very superstitious. I think you become kind of paranoid. And I've seen that happen very often with people. So all of these have a kind of a plus and a minus on how you do it. The power and the big thing that I want to hit today is that everybody has the ability to develop each one of these. People get smarter that read books, that study, that push their mind. Their IQ increases, period. It's just the way it works. You do have a natural propensity in certain ways, but everybody can develop the pieces that they think they're weak in. I feel like I've really made huge leaps and bounds in emotional intelligence. I feel like I was not gifted with that. During my teenage years, I feel like I had a very, very low EQ. And as I have developed it and tried to seek it, I feel like it is definitely growing. So that's something to bear in mind. That was maybe some deep stuff there. We went a little deep on that one, but really consider that. Look at your life and you might start to see some patterns. What's done for me as well, though, is I also look at people and I say, they may not be like me, but man, they probably know a lot of things I don't. Everybody out there is smarter than me in some way. Because again, there's different kinds of intelligence, and to think, and I've met a lot of people that intellectually blow me out of the water, and I feel like an idiot around them. But then I look a little deeper, and I'm like, you know, but I do think that I might have maybe a little bit higher, I don't know, maybe a spiritual intelligence or a maybe a little higher emotional intelligence or whatever. Not that it's a competition, but it's nice to know that if you, as many people I know, they feel dumb, right? They're like, I just feel like I'm just not very smart. Really? I don't believe anybody has none of these. I really don't. Look and find the one that you have really strong. You're going to find that it's often one of these. And you are brilliant in your own way. I hope that you take this for whatever it's worth to you. I hope that it lets you grow and develop and consider different things. And more than anything, I hope it keeps your mind open, that everyone can teach you something. And that's what it's done for me, is I've realized how far I was from true intelligence. We are all painfully ignorant in our own ways, and everyone out there can teach us something. So I will see you on the next episode. Thank you for spending this time with me today, and we'll talk to you next time.